questions, we'll...
Yeah, we'd like to ask the first questions.
We are, yes.
Yeah, I mean, you all know who we are, right?
Yeah.
So we don't need to go into that.
I want to hear the voice.
Of...
Lord Zed.
Oh, the witches, you shall be mine.
I'm going to go blank when I see witches. I wish I had a script with me.
You shall be mine. I shall get into Super Terror and destroy Angel Grove. Ha ha!
I got a real quick question. My only question is host, one of my only few questions. What inspired you? Like, what were there other characters that maybe you looked to for inspiration on, like, emotion and inflection to add to the voice?
Well, obviously Darth Vader was an influence because he was hot at the time.
Yeah.
And I had actually done a character a year before called Lumbar Hist, who I based the voice on. He was the bad guy in the L. Ron Hubbard Decology Mission Earth. He was like the head of the interstellar FBI. He was modeled after J. Edgar Hoover, personality wise, but he was a small, hissy guy. So I made his voice very nasal and hissy. It was a great voice. And, funny, I auditioned with it and didn't get the job because I was too scary.
Damn.
I thought I had it, but I got to use the voice somehow. So when Lord Zed came about, I thought, well, let me see if I can imagine this voice into Lord Zed. And Lord Zed, of course, had to, instead of putting it up in the nose, I put it down in the diaphragm. So this became this. And that's, I tried to make him slow, like dog legs, slow and meaningful. Intense. That's how I It came from God, actually. I believe in that, that sometimes when you do auditions, sometimes it just comes to me. So that's a gift from God. Sometimes I have to work at it, but luckily I have a lot of training in acting to be able to get to that point through hard work. Anyway, enough of that.
You there.
The question for Johnny. Who is your favorite? Is it Turbo, Zio, or Mighty Morphin?
Well, see, it's kind of weird because I was still just Adam all throughout. I just changed my clothes, you know. it's all still kind of the same to me. But I did have, I mean, it's hard because Mighty Morphin was my first break, you know. I was working at Subway before that. So it's like Subway and then Power Rangers. So it's a big highlight. But then Zio was fun because I got to do more things in Zio. You know, like in Mighty Morphin, I was always just kind of the background ranger. You know, I didn't really have a whole lot to do. Occasionally I had some things to do, but there was not really a lot like centered around Adam, you know. Not a lot, there's like one or two. But then Zio got quite a bit more to do, so it was fun. And then Turbo, I felt like, was really starting to turn out to be a lot of fun for me as an actor, because then I started to think about acting. I was just a martial artist, and I just luckily landed this job, and then it was just along for the ride. And it wasn't until like Turbo when I was like, I need to start thinking about what I'm doing here. And as I was doing that, like later on towards my end, then we got replaced. Then we were basically fired. Then I was like, dang. So yeah, I don't know. There's moments in there that I really enjoyed. I don't know if I really have a favorite, but I prefer wearing black. It's half Asian and green makes me look pale.
Anything better than the frog, right?
The frog wasn't so bad. I added that line in the movie. It was actually, she just tells me that I'm a frog and I'm the most agile and quick or something like that. It had more to do with speed. In fact, we shot a lot of other stuff, training sequences, and my thing was speed, being very fast. And kind of a long story, but I'll make it really quick. But like the first script, Black Ranger had a lot of really cool action sequences, and there's a revision that happened, and all those were given to another Ranger. And then I was like, well, that's weird. And the producers, well, they complained, and they have seniority, and so, you know, I was like, wow, that sucks. And so I was bummed. And we got to that scene, I was just bummed out about just not having anything to do in the film. And I asked the director if I could just be bummed out about getting the frog. And he was like, well, let's do it like the script, and then we'll try it your way. And so we tried it that way, and they're like, oh, we like that. Yeah, let's play with that. And so that's what it was cool. Yes?
How did you get that role?
As Adam?
Yeah.
I went to an audition. I studied Shaolin Kung Fu at the time in Texas. And my instructor was looking at the paper, and he saw an article that said they're looking for new Rangers. It didn't specify whether or not it was stunt guys or what, because that was something I asked. And he was like, I don't know. It just says new Rangers. But you had to have like martial arts or gymnastics or dancing ability. And so I just went in, and there's, you know, there's thousands of people auditioning in Dallas, but they had it, like it's a nationwide search. They just ended up choosing the three of us from Dallas. Well, we did do callbacks in California. But
what's that belt are you?
What's that?
Do you have belts in that art?
I have various belts in various arts. I never stuck to one thing. Like I did Shaolin Kung Fu probably the longest, and then I moved on. Once I got Power Rangers, I left Texas and I was in California. So I ended up studying with a lot of the stunt guys who came from various different arts as well. But currently I do a lot of jiu-jitsu, and I study Eskrima and some Filipino martial arts.
What's your highest belt?
My highest belt? Well, see, I've got honorary belts as well, so. Belts are they're only good to hold your pants up. I could say I'm an honorary, the highest would be black, but that doesn't really matter, you know. I can fight, if that's what you're asking.
What's your strongest discipline?
What's the strongest discipline?
They're like when you feel like this is my A game.
That's tricky. It depends, really, because, okay, so I feel very confident in my stand-up game, and I feel very confident if I have a stick or a knife as well. Because I study Eskrima, and I feel very...
Filipino stick fighting, correct?
Yeah, well, Eskrima is not just stick fighting, but everybody thinks it is.
It's lever action motion.
Well, there's a lot of hand-to-hand.
Yeah.
You know, it's very similar to Jeet Kune Do.
Yeah.
But there's a lot of sticks, and there's a lot of knives. And so that's really, really cool. But Jiu-Jitsu, I think, is one of the most practical martial arts. Because most fights, even before I studied Jiu-Jitsu, I would, in a real fight, would go to the ground many, many times. So if you know some groundwork, then I think you'll be okay. And I think spending some time in jiu-jitsu is worth it, because most people don't get past, you know, really white belt. You know, they kind of give up, because it takes a long time to move on from white belt. You know, once you get blue or purple, then you're gonna be all right up against most people. But in the street.
Thank you.
Yeah, sure.
You there.
Okay, question for Robert. How do you prepare voices? Because like in Power Rangers, you switch from Finster to Lord. How do you prepare when you're getting ready to do like a specific voice, or if you're juggling between voices?
I work the voice a little bit in the car. Just for Finster, I just do, oh, my queen. Oh, my queen. Yes, my queen. I do that a few times, and that gets me to the head.
Yeah, because that's like more in your normal voice, I guess.
Yeah, it's my normal voice. I'm a little nasal, and it's mostly attitude.
Yeah.
It's very propitious to me.
Do you find that you have like a line that gets you into certain characters?
Yes. With Zed, it was, Power Rangers, the earth shall be mine. Which is what they put in the toy. They lifted it off one of the, I didn't see a penny. They lifted it off one of the episodes, put that in the talking toy, pressed the button. Earth will be mine.
Do you guys have like action figures of yourself?
Yeah. Yeah, quite a few, yeah. No, not a shelf in my bedroom. I look at it every day.
Well done, Johnny. No, they're actually in boxes. Because I've done various, you know, I Power Rangers have been voiceover and video games and stuff. So I have a bunch of other characters, and they're just in boxes. There are certain ones that I'll have out, but yeah, it's kind of weird.
That's actually.
Be, you should have like a giant.
I have a couple of Zeds in boxes.
You know, I mean, like in a glass thing. Standing or sitting on a throne in your living room. Right in front of the TV. You can sit right next to him and watch TV. Trigun was my first thing. Wolf's Rain, I think, was maybe my second or third. But basically, I was on Power Rangers, and for a couple of years, I couldn't get a job. It was very hard at that time. Because back then, there wasn't a whole lot of, like, I'm half Asian. I don't know if you can tell. In the mornings, you can tell, because I'm like... and you're like, oh, that guy's Asian. No, so it's very hard for me to book a role because anytime I went in, it was very specific, like Chinese guy or Asian, and then if I go in and there's a dude that's like, hello, then that guy's gonna get the job. So it was like that very often, and sometimes I'd go in and it'd be for a Caucasian role and I just wouldn't get it because some blonde head dude would get it, you know? So I just had a really tough time booking a role after Power Rangers. Also, when they found out I was from Power Rangers, then they're like, I'm not as interested for whatever reason. And then so luckily the stunt guys who were Japanese from Power Rangers wanted to do this action film and cast me as the lead in it. And the camera was Japanese, but the sound crew and their equipment wasn't. So somehow that it didn't work right. And so at the end of the day, when they had the film finished, there was no audio. So I had to go in and dub myself. As I was dubbing myself, the producer walked in and he was like, oh, hey, you got a good hero voice. I was like, thanks. And he's like, I'm doing this animation stuff or whatever, why don't you come and audition? I was like, sure, because I needed a job. So I went in, auditioned for Trigun, and I booked the role, and that just kind of opened the door for me. Which was great, because then it didn't matter what I looked like, you know, because then I could play, you know, like Bash is just like a white dude with blonde hair, you know, so I fooled people. And so luckily, that kind of really just, it saved me, really, kind of gave me a new, way to express myself as an actor. It really opened up the doors for me quite a bit, and then it just went from there. Other questions?
I was actually thinking when you said how you had met with stuntmen and met with people who did different martial arts styles. Each of the Rangers had their own distinctive sort of character when it came to fighting and everything. What styles sort of measured, what did you look to most when you were looking on how to develop your Ranger? Poise behind the fist or something.
Well, I mean, because my background was more kung fu.
Yeah.
And so I really tried to, that was really just more what I brought to my character.
Yeah.
Before that was Walter. He was a dancer.
Yeah.
And he did hip-hop keto. And he came up with that hip-hop keto. So that was like his thing. Which I didn't really know because I didn't really watch the show. But so I just came in as a kung fu guy because I knew nobody else was doing kung fu. Everyone did have a very specific style.
Were there any big names that really influenced you? Because you talked about meeting some stunts people in the industry.
Were there stunt guys that I met?
Yeah.
You said that. Yeah, I did.
Yeah. Were there any like big guys that really brush off on you like for times to come?
Oh yeah, well there's you guys won't know him. But I know him because he studied, well, coolest things he studied under Dan Inosanto. Who was like Bruce Lee's like guy.
Yeah, one of his top guys.
And so, and he was like one of his go-to guys. Tsuyoshi Abe is his name. And I learned quite a bit from like just a couple of things that I did with him. And just some small details in delivering kicks and certain things that, you know, it changed my perspective when approaching, you know, a fight and, you know, certain things. So, but, hard to explain, but yeah, that was one character.
No, that's fascinating.
You there. How grueling was the filming schedule?
Well, we shot 4 episodes a week, basically. It was intense. It was crazy. Often we had like 14-hour days. And then,
this was a 5-day-a-week show.
Every single day. We would do ADR in the evenings or on the weekends. So we were just constantly working.
Everybody know what ADR is?
That's the voiceover.
Dubbing. Yes. It's a fancy term for dubbing. So it says for automated dialogue replacement.
So basically,
the only thing that's not automated is us.
Yeah. So you know what? The helmet heads, basically. You know. Can I see the helmet real quick? So, you know, most of it was this.
Right. Okay. Come on. You know, anytime the head bob like that, you gotta go to the voice. Let's do it. All right. We're awesome. You know what I'm
saying? I mean, that's what we did most of the time, so it was super easy. Didn't have to match any lip flaps or anything like that for most of the time.
So wait, with choreography on set then, having those, I mean, did that like mess with your peripheral vision at all when you were trying to choreograph
on set? A lot of it was stock footage.
Yeah.
You know, and occasionally we would have those on, but we didn't do a whole lot of fighting with those. You know, we would maybe do a move and take our helmets off.
Oh, just to catch your breath and stuff.
Most of it was, the stunt guys did do a lot of that stuff later on, but a lot of it was stock footage.
Okay.
You guys just, because if it was stock footage from Japan, then you guys would just honestly just do like the American voiceovers, I guess.
Exactly, yeah. I mean, they did shoot a lot of it as well, because they had to like tie it into, you know, because the problem with the stock footage is that there's always like Asian people, because it's a Japanese show. So if the, you know, the monster's like terrorizing the city, it's like always Asian guys running away, you know? It's like, oh, that's interesting. So they had to like tie it in and shoot some other stuff as well to show some like other people.
They only attacked Chinatown.
Right.
In San Francisco.
Is in Chinatown. Yeah.
Because what I liked about the show a lot was when you guys were actually fighting in your street clothes.
Civilians, yeah.
Yeah, the civilian fights. Those were kind of cool, and then they took it away because they thought it was too violent, whatever. But you guys must have had, like, because that's where you kind of got to do.
Yeah, we did quite a bit. We got to do quite a bit of, well, yeah, I mean, I think we did. We did quite a bit. Civilian fights, whatever. They didn't take it away. What they did for us is they took away what we can do. Like, you can never hit to the face, you know, which is always tricky because, you know, you do a jump kick, you jump up in the air, but then you'd have to kick really low because then you have to hit them in the chest or whatever. And a lot of stunt guys would get kicked in the face because it's just different, you know. But yeah, there's a lot of that was taken. Certain moves and things, you couldn't kick to the groin or punch the groin or any of that stuff. It had to, you know, to their chest. And that's, they put the thing in their chest, you know.
Yeah.
They did that, they pull up.
Yeah, no buddies, yeah.
Buddies, yeah.
Buddies. Yes.
Yeah. Johnny, so for the first Mighty Morphin movie, did you know how to rollerblade, or did you have to learn?
Nope. No. Actually, when I first came to the show, the ninja encounter or whatever, we had to do rollerblading, and it was the first thing. Like, and I remember we had already been doing a lot, like wardrobes and rehearsal, and stunt rehearsal, and then going through, we were already shooting a few things, and then like, I don't know, it was like a couple weeks in, we're at Cascade Park where we shot a lot of stuff, and it's early in the morning, they're setting lights up, and I got these rollerblades on, I'm like, I gotta figure out how to do this. And I'm just going down the sidewalk, and I'm starting to get an idea of like how to like maintain my balance, or at least look like I know what I'm doing, And the dew was there, the sun was coming up, dew was on the grass, and I remember I was by myself, and it hit me, because I always wanted to do, like, action movies, and wanted to be, like, an action star, and you know, I was like, it hit me at that moment, you know, that I was like, man, this is it, this is exactly what I wanted to do, you know, so it was a cool feeling, although I was like, I don't know what I'm doing, you know, but luckily, it's like the camera would be set there, and we have to go from here to there,
and you just go as fast as you can. Just make it past the camera, you can fall over, it doesn't matter. So that's what happened most of the times. You go and then fall into the grass or whatever. But the same thing in the movie. It wasn't like after that day I was like always rollerblading. It was like after that we moved on to many other things and then we're shooting the movie and it's like, and you guys are rollerblading. And I was like, uh-oh. Yeah, and so I had to figure out some things, but I picked it up fairly quickly. Like I figured out how to go backwards and stuff like that, or how to spin. But then they did have some like pro rollerbladers come in and do some stuff, you know.
And no, I can do that.
Yeah.
I used to play hockey.
Yeah.
That was a long time. Roller hockey, nice one.
He actually was the one who doubled me.
Yes.
The
Roy's head on skates. What do you guys imagine?
Oh, you and the...
Lord said on ice. They should Lord do that.
I was going to ask, could you morph for us?
Can I morph?
Yeah. Do you remember how to morph?
I remember how to morph, yes. But, I don't remember all of it. There's many versions. The first version was this. It's morphing time. That was it. Put our hand behind, like on our butt, basically. And then it became, we pull out our morpher out of our butt. It's like, it's morpher time, then we go here. Oh, there it is.
You gotta do it right, right?
Is music on?
Alright. It's morpher time!
And transform. Alright, there you go.
Yeah, it got cooler. Yes.
What's the best prank you guys have
done? Best prank? I didn't do a lot of pranks. It's Jason Frank, who I call Jason Prank. He did a lot. Let's see. I won't tell this story. I'll just say this. There's a tree flip story, which you might have heard, where Jason blamed it on his face, and he blames me. But it's his fault. And I'll let him tell that one. But I'll tell you how he got his revenge on me. We're in Australia. We're in this van. This lady is driving us. And Jason and I are in the middle seat. The girls are in the back. The windows were open. And I'm doing that thing where I'm like grabbing the wind, doing this, whatever. And out loud, I don't know why, I was young, I was stupid. I was like, it'd be really cool if I climbed out this window and got on the roof and landed on the other side. We're going 50 miles an hour through this desert to get to location. And Jason looks at me, he's like, he won't do it. I was like, dude, I'll climb out right now and get on the roof and ride like Teen Wolf, get in on the other side. And he's like, nah, you're a chicken. And I was like, no, I'm the frog. And I climbed out the window, and I got onto the roof. This lady just kept driving 50 miles an hour. Inside the car, it was fun because you could grab the wind or whatever, but on the roof, it's like... Like, it dawned on me, I was like, I could die. And then I'm like, well, I should finish and get in on the other side. But then suddenly the van starts swerving, and my legs are going side by side, and I'm hanging on for dear life. I'm like, what is she doing? And I pull myself forward so I can kind of scream at her from the windshield. And I see that she's frightened like this because Jason Frank has reached past her and is pulling at the wheel and trying to throw me from the vehicle. 50 miles an hour, he's trying to throw me from this vehicle, making it swerve back and forth. I'm like, holy crap, he's trying to kill me. I get over to try to get in on the side window, and there he is, rolling it up. This lady continues driving 50 miles an hour, and finally starts hitting him, and then he rolls it down, and I climb back in. She never stopped. She never slowed down. And that was really dumb. That was how I got back from the whole tree flip deal.
That's what we call a Jewish equation. Any Jews in there?
Everybody.
Joke. All right.
It's a question for Johnny. So after you kind of wrapped up like your regular appearances as Adam on all the series, and you kind of came back later on for some of the crossovers, was that like the producers calling you, or did you kind of keep your like hands in the pot, saying like, hey, if you want me up here and available, kind of thing?
When I came back in space and Overdrive?
Yeah, yeah.
No, I just kind of moved on, and I was doing other things, voiceover, whatever else.
doing. And Koichi Sakamoto, who was the stunt coordinator at Remain, second unit guy, and ran Alpha Stunts, he asked me to come back, or if I wanted to come back, and I was like, space, whatever. First off, there's kind of an issue because I had a previous relationship with one of the females that was on, and I was like, I don't know if I want to come back. But he was like, yeah, it's going to be fine, or whatever. And I was like, sure. So I went back. It was kind of a cool episode. It was fun. But then I asked him, I was like, because, like, okay, so my morpher was, my coin was busted,
yeah.
Right? So I was supposed to use that, and then it's like, dangerous. You can kill yourself. And then I remember asking him if I could die. I was like, do you think that Adam, it would be kind of cool if he does die while doing this, you know? Maybe saves the day, but then he dies. And Koichi was like, no. And everyone was like, no, he can't die. I'm like, oh, come on.
No dying.
No dying, yes. Eventually they killed some people, but it was much later. And then Overdrive was the same thing. I was like, can I die in this movie? I just wanted to go out like with something cool, you know? And they're like, no, this is Disney now. Nobody's going to die. I was like, have you seen Up? Disney movie or Pixar, they all die in the first 15 minutes. But again, they wouldn't let me die. But but it was fun. Did I answer the question?
Yeah.
Okay.
Actually, a little follow-up question on that, on the note of no death and those types of movies. Theoretical question, hypothetical. How do you think a mature Power Rangers movie would be received? You know, just like crazy, over-exaggerated.
Well, they did that. Did you see that? They did that Power Ranger fan film.
I don't think I saw it, no.
I'm sure you can find it on YouTube.
Yeah, I was going to say it on YouTube.
Yeah, it's definitely much more adult.
Like heads popping.
Well, there's like half-naked girls, and, you know, Zach is doing cocaine.
Oh my God.
The Rangers are getting hunted down and
shot.
So
it's like,
yeah, oh, it's real.
Blood Diamond is
it actually so looks well done. No, they had a, it was actually kind of cool. It was like Michael Bay, you know, got the rights to the Power Rangers and then shot like a short.
Big explosions.
It's actually kind of cool, but it was definitely far from, you know.
Far from camps and everything like that.
Like post-apocalyptic.
Yeah, it was very, it was interesting though. Yeah. The Machine Empire had like.
Is that online?
It is online, yeah. I think it's just called Access Danger. Well, if you do fan film, you'll find like other ones too. Like Zordon.
If you do a Google search, you'll bring that.
Yeah, just Google search Ranger. I think it's just called Power Rangers, right? Yeah, Power Rangers. And it's pretty intense. It's crazy. Like when I saw it, I was like, dude, their budget looked bigger than ours. Like, how do they get their Zords to look so cool? But yeah, they did really well. It was very interesting.
Is it a full-length movie or?
No, it's a short.
Short.
But it's kind of a complete idea. It's like Power Rangers meets Starship Troopers or something. It's pretty interesting. But the new film kind of went a little darker.
Yeah, a little bit darker.
You know?
Well, that's the trend.
The new film was great. I loved it. It's very,
had a lot of humanity. Yeah, I thought they did a good job with it. I think they could have thrown in a few more cameos. not just Jason and Kimberly.
Another question?
Yeah, actually, one more quick follow-up question before I get this back to the audience. Just on the note of practical jokes and knowing how much your voice filled me with dread as a child, were there ever times where you're like, you know, if I played a recorder of my voice in this person's room while they're sleeping, I could probably get scared. But did you ever get fun with your voice, just messing with other castmates?
Well, I was too busy playing racquetball.
True.
Yeah.
Okay.
It was a running joke that I always showed up to work in my black shorts because I was the racquetball game waiting for me.
Really?
So, yeah, because my racquetball session was so far away to
studios.
So yeah, so
racquetball by day and slaying Rangers by night.
Yeah. So,
Okay, well,
yeah. I think I got on the phone a couple of times.
Yeah, just have a little like moment where you catch your family members by surprise when they call. Just like, oh,
my family
this isn't
across the show.
Oh, no.
My mother kept asking, and what time is it on? For 2 years. Come on, it's on 4 o'clock on channel 5. Okay.
That's when you go and you sit down in the first time.
They were very, my family was not very supportive. Except when I started making money.
You there.
This is kind of for Robert. So now, would you guys do, like when you do the voiceovers, would you ever do it together, or would you kind of do yours separately?
It was, for the most part, they bring us in one at a time.
Okay.
I remember working with you one day on something. But that's out of how many years?
Yeah.
It was mostly go in and do line after line after line. If I had Vince Lorenzo on the same day, I'd be Vince the Coast. And line back to the beginning and do all the same stuff. So it's pretty cut and dry. I worked with Barbara a couple of times when the scenes were really close.
Now, did you ever get to look at a monitor, or are you just like,
oh, yeah.
You just read the script?
Yeah, we looked at the monitor and matched it. I didn't have to match lip movements, but
yeah,
I had to match physical movements. Like this with the staff, I had to frame the words.
And sorry,
yes, yeah.
Did you ever visit the set at all?
Did I what?
Did you ever visit the set?
Once or twice when I wanted to go hit the craft services. See what they were serving for the day. But no, I pretty much did my thing and ran out of there to play racquetball. Sometimes I have an audition right after you tonight. We were up in Valencia. I don't know if you're familiar with California, but it was about a 30, 40 minute drive from the part of LA where I was. So I had to rush back into town if I had an audition or something like that. Try to beat the traffic. I had an afternoon session. But once it was 3 o'clock, 3:30 comes, and you know what LA traffic is. Ridiculous.
Just like downtown Toronto.
Yeah. Yeah, imagine that all over town. Yeah.
Actually, you know, on the, oh wait, yeah, you were next. You were next. Your question first. You, sir. Yes,
this
go
for
ahead.
John. Did you like Alan your Sherlin sword or the Zeo sword?
Wait, what is that?
Did you like piling your
Shogun sword?
Or your Zeo sword?
With the Zio, it was all the same to me. It was all stock footage. The only time that I ever got inside anything like that was for the movie.
Which was your favorite one?
With the frog.
The frog?
Yeah.
The Shogun?
Yeah, the Shogun was cool. But
or no, the Zio.
The Zio one was also cool, but I was never inside it. Yeah, it was, yeah, we. It was just the movie one that I actually got to sit inside, you know, because they built the interior. They built, like, basically it was just the inside. It wasn't as cool when you look at the outside. It was like a giant box. Like, okay, what is this again? Oh, it's a frog, okay. You just sit and inside, it feels like a cockpit, you know. Then outside, it was just a giant box.
Alrighty, so we have time for about maybe 2-3 more questions before we gotta wrap up, so anyone else? Well, you've been asking a lot, so we'll give him a chance over here.
Is there any way that you can do Ichigo's
life? Ichigo's
life? Yeah.
Oh, Hollow Ichigo.
Hollow.
Okay. So for those of you who don't know, I also do voiceover. And Ichigo is a character I played in Bleach, and you got him on a shirt. And there's a part of him where he kind of, there's this inner kind of demon inside of him, so this is his laugh. Like you, I have always have like a line or something that gets me in the character.
Yeah.
For him, it's always like, who am I?
Yes! Yes! Is that a small one?
But yeah, I do. I always have online. It's a lot of times it's like the first line from the character or from the audition or something.
I like the line that Zed had. When I want your opinion, I'll give it to you.
Sucks. That sucks. All right, another question. Preferably from someone who hasn't asked you? Okay, there we go. There we go.
Question for both of you. 20 years ago, whenever, when Mighty Morphin started, did you guys ever think that Power Rangers would have the legacy that it has? And what's it like still having that fan base and coming to all these conventions and stuff?
No, I didn't. I mean, I didn't know what to expect. I wasn't even looking that far in the future. And so I was just like, yay, this is fun. And then when it's gone, I was like, I gotta get a job. But it's been great. It's been awesome. It's kind of cool to be a part of, I remember like being on set, I would meet like little kids, like they're, you know, they'd have like the costume tape up, but then afterwards you can go say hi and sign some autographs and take pictures or whatever. And so years later, seeing those same kids, you know, much older, first off, makes me feel old, but second is just like, holy cow, that's crazy, you know? And I try to think back on some of the people that I used to look up to or whatever, you know, and how cool it would have been to meet like Bruce Lee, but he died, you know. And so like when I saw Jackie Chan for the first time, I was like, that's Jackie Chan! That's Jackie Chan! I was like freaking out, but so I get it, I understand, you know, it's awesome.
Well, I was in Power Rangers from the beginning, and I've been working for Saban for like 9 years, so I was in their stable of actors. So Tony Oliver came to me and said, you're going to play Finster. I said, oh, this is another Saban show, the last 26 or 52 episodes. It's nice. Finster had a few lines to say every episode. And it was pretty cool. So, okay, we'll do this show. We were just finishing up a show called Hello Spencer, which was a Muppet-type show from Germany. It was a cute show. And so we started doing the Power Rangers, and wow, this show is weird. But about episode 20, Saban came, Hyam came down and said, we have something big going on. He didn't want to, he was afraid we'd start asking for more money, which we did. But by episode 20, we knew we had a hit on our hands. And but who knew that this would blossom into, what are they, about 22 years now? And would be conventions, and this is my residual checks, though. The show is non-union.
Yes.
So I did the last three episodes union, and so I get residuals for that, like $9, 25 cents or something.
I remember that story that I thought was really interesting. Like, they didn't want you to audition for Lord Zedd, right? Or it was like, you had to really try.
I asked Scott Page, he said, yeah, you can audition, but then I had to do three auditions, because they didn't think it was me. And I finally called up Eric Waldman, who's one of the producers, the executive producer. I said, what's going on? Because in the third audition, they didn't have anybody else with me. So I said, what's going on, Eric? He said, well, we don't think it's you. They actually wanted to know if I could maintain the voice over a long period of time, because it sounds like it's really hurting my throat, but it doesn't. Smoke enough Marlboros and get to that space.
Sorry to say this, but we are running out of time.
Anyway, after the third episode, after the third audition, I convinced him to retire. That's the story.
One the Almighty.
All right, thank you guys so much for.